happened?
Now I'm recording again.
Can you record, Barb?
It's recording, leave it on.
Well, it is so good to see y'all.
Hey, man.
It's been a minute. Hey, it's been a minute for us, the walks of life. I'm so glad to see y'all pretty faces. And shout out to Dawana, wherever you at out here, girl. We send you some love your way.
Right. And right. Happy belated birthday.
Yeah, she did. She celebrated her birthday. I did go to her gathering out where she had it at. I did go. It was really nice. Yeah, it was nice. So I had a good time with family.
We went to a nice Thai restaurant yesterday and had dinner.
See, that was nice. Okay. That's what's up. So I know we opened with prayer, and I know that today's our topic is we're discussing coping with drug and alcohol with a loved one, right? We know that it's wrapped around what happened with the iconic legendary DMX. We know that he always opened with prayer. With all you know, he ended with prayer. He opened with prayer with his music. Is that right?
Okay.
So, in honor of him today and his memory, if y'all okay with it, I want to open up with one of his prayers that I went and found that we probably heard a few times in the past. You know, he's a part of our era. It was one of my favorite ones that he would recite when I was out there in the world. we were all struggling with our faith. So I found one for us today, y'all. So here we go.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, it is you who wakes me up every day. Father God, I'm just learning how to pray. Bear with me.
Sorry.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, it is you who wakes me up every day. And I am forever grateful for your love. This is why I pray. You let me touch so many people. And it's all for the good. I influenced so many children. I never thought that I would. And I couldn't take credit for the love they get. Because it all comes from you, Lord. I'm just the one that's giving it. And when it seems like the pressure gets to be too much, I take time out and pray. And ask that you be my crutch. Lord, I am not perfect by a long shot. I confess to you daily. But I work hard every day. And I hope that you hear me. In my heart, I mean well. But if you'll help me to grow, what I have in my heart. And when I get going, I'm not looking back for nothing. Because I will know where I'm headed. And I'm so tired of the suffering. I stand before you, a weakened version of your reflection. Begging for direction, for my soul needs resurrection. I don't deserve what you've given me, but you never took it from me. Because I am grateful, and I use it, and I do not worship money. If what you want from me is to bring your children to you, my regret is only having one life to do it, instead of two.
Amen.
Amen.
Rest in peace, Earl Simmons, DMX. He was like a family member to a lot of us. I know to me, in my household, it was my era. I don't know if y'all were able to even look on our page. I wrote the thing up, in his regard and how he came about. How I learned about him was from my brother. My brother, he passed away in 2008. And I don't know, he was not even born in the East Coast, but he dressed like a East Coast. He wore Timberlands. He was slew-footed. He ran by himself. And he was like a mirror of him. And my brother loved music. He loved East Coast music. He loved music, period. And he was like, listen to this dude right here. And I'm like, who is that? He was like, DMX. And from then on, it was just his voice, the words the words that he would put out there. It wasn't always about, call us out of our name. He just was, living, telling his truth. And from that day forth, I just been a DMX. I can't say I was his fan. I was his family member. He didn't even know we were sisters and brothers. So when he passed away, it just, man, it for real, it hit me like I had lost my brother all over again. I had called a lot of my male cousins. I'm like, cuz, our man's gone. I made some calls like, man, our man's gone. Because it really hit home, even with my husband. I'm like, man, this felt like, you know, like it was so close to home, you know. And I guess now, you know, we're not promised tomorrow, you know, and just prepare ourselves, you know, each day and repent and try to live, you know, live right. That's pretty much it. And so,
well, let's open up. Go ahead on. Open up and introduce yourself.
Okay, thank you. Hey, everybody, I'm Mocha, say but about that life.
And I'm Bentley, Purpose and Passion.
And I'm Barb, the boss.
And we are the Walks of Life. Hey, everybody. It's been a minute for us. Look here, we're getting back in a group of things right now. It's been a minute for us, but look here, we're going to be back. We get some new things put in place. It's gonna be a good thing, you know. Right now, Miss Dewana, our corporate, she's took, you know, a personal break right now, but she will be in and out during this season, and we'll see how things go. But right now, we're gonna keep this train to roll for real. Yeah. So today's topic is coping with drug and alcohol with a loved one. What that looks like. How it may have affected you or some, you know, someone who you may have known, or even yourself, if ever, you know, and how that affected you, you know, mentally, physically, you know, knowing someone who have, you know, used alcohol or drugs and whatever. Me, myself, I guess I'll start with myself because I'm the one who asked. I had, you know, a life experience. I have really seen the ins and outs of what drug and alcohol can do, especially when it's an overindulgence in it, you know, when it's going beyond, when you don't have no self-control over it. People say it ain't hurting you, it do hurt you. When it's some, you know, when you love that person and you're seeing them now self-destruct, it is hurting you because I love you. So you hurting you, you're hurting me. So what about one of y'all? Bentley, you had that experience at all?
Well, yeah, I've had several experiences being one who was addicted to the drugs and the alcohol myself at one point for about 19 years. I know that for a long time, I was a functioning addict where a lot of people didn't really know. They didn't fully know that I had an addiction.
Wow.
Because I didn't, I wasn't out there stealing and robbing and selling myself and, you know, emptying out my house. It was being provided to me, you know, supplied to me by mainly men that were interested in me. And believe it or not, and that went from, and these, I was never a woman who dope dated or would have, you know, those women, but I always had men that had a lot of money that was really interested in me. If they sold it or if they bought it and gave it to me, they did that to try to supply my habit to keep me from going out and having to do anything gutter, so to speak, to. I didn't really, it didn't fully start affecting my family until I began to do the whole disappearing acts. And then it began to show the wear and tear on my everyday appearance, because for a long time, again, as I say, as a functioning addict, you know, I looked the same way every day. I dressed really good. I always flipped cars. You know, okay. I had a lot of money, idea what I wanted to do. I went where I wanted to go and I wasn't broke. But it wasn't until that last, you know, the ending of the journey where it began to show. And then
I was going to ask you that next. Yeah,
my behavior changed, you know, became erratic. You know, I started doing things that I wouldn't normally do. Just a lot of the things that, you know, I'm not ashamed anymore, but it was a lot of things that I regret that I even had, you know, family and friends had to experience through me. And, I also just wanted to say, it's a lot of times, a lot of people that are functioning addicts, you know, if they have the ability to maintain, people wouldn't know that they have an addiction. They would not know unless they began to run dry, Because if they have a consistency in their pattern, you wouldn't know that they're on anything. I mean, for many years, I ran with, when I was out there, I dealt with millionaires who had a lot of money, who, you know, you wouldn't even know that they had a real addiction and they had real heavy addictions, but their pattern was consistent. And it was the same way, you know, day after day, you're in, you're out, you know, these, you wouldn't know just on the surface. You'd have to be in deep to know that they really had an addiction. And that means they could still go to work all day. They can be in the office. They can still make logical decisions, good choice. They could still function and everything flowed. They didn't have the visible signs of I'm an addict. Right.
Let's pause right there for a quick second. Please hold that thought right there, okay? Because I got where you were just stopping at. Hold that part. Barb DeBoss. I know, you know, you're also from the DMX era as well. You know, I'm not sure what you know, would you a big fan or anything, but with to coincide, you know, with our hot topics today, have you experienced it at all? You know, and if so, are you able to elaborate with us and the viewers as well?
I have experienced it from people that's really, really close. It was it's hurtful. Especially if you know the people before they actually, became a drug or alcohol abuser, because you're trying to always help them get it back, which scars you up, because if they're not ready, they're not ready. Mm-hmm. I was visiting a place where it was like all recovering addicts and alcoholics, and a guy told me one time, you know, that a person who isn't the drug and alcohol abuser also need counseling mm-hmm. in order to help you understand the person who is abusive to the drug and alcohol. So that was like, wow, because I had never thought about me needing counseling or figuring out how to deal with it.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's new for me to even know that.
They were saying that the people who have to deal with those people also need counseling to help them get through.
Wow.
Because it's traumatizing. It's very trauma. It's mm-hmm. a lot of trauma, especially when you're seeing somebody you love, whether, you know, usually if you're close to it, it don't matter what, it doesn't matter if they got a consistent routine when you're close in the home with it, or you know, when it's really close, like, it's still painful whether they functional or not, you know, because they're hurting someone, because people love, when you love somebody, you know, you just know that it's not going in a good direction.
Got a question for you both then. Should there be boundaries with someone that we love, that we've known, you know, known past tense or even now, should there be boundaries put in place because I love you, I can't be around you?
I mean, and when you say boundaries,
that boundaries mean, you know, I can't come around you, you know, or, you know, or removing yourself. Because what I'm saying is, the question was asked about DMF. It was like, well, where was his peoples at? Where was his team at? Why didn't they help? Because now they're all being like a finger pointed at them, because why didn't you stop this?
Oh, okay.
I don't know about you both. Have you ever been told that? Why don't you know, you was there, you saw him.
So, okay. You want to go first, Barb?
You want to go?
You can go. I'll wait.
Okay.
I made a statement about, you know, all people, right? Some people live their life hidden while others live their life out loud. So if you know that your cousin is a thief, or your spouse is a thief, and that they're stealing all the time, do you set boundaries? Of course you do. If you know that, you know, your relative or your friend or whatever is, you know, sleep with anybody, sleep with everybody, he, she, and they in between, do you set boundaries? Absolutely. So, you know, drug addiction is no different than any other thing that you want to set boundaries for, because you don't, it's unpredictable. And when anything is unpredictable, even if you predict it, it's still unpredictable, because I know you're a drug addict. Okay, I know you're a thief. Oh, okay, I know you're a thief, but you still set boundaries, you know. But does that mean, you know, for those who don't, you know they have a habit, but they never stole. They know they don't have a history of robbing folks or things coming up missing out of the house, mm-hmm. or them doing low down, disgusting, degrading things to get the drug. Do you necessarily need to set boundaries for that? I would say no.
Okay. Barb?
I feel like you gotta set some personal boundaries because it's painful. But
what does that look like when you say personal boundaries? What would that look like for that loved one?
So at the point of it hurting me, sometimes you gotta pull back a little bit.
Okay.
Because when we're talking about drug addictions and stuff, this is something that they didn't make the choice to be to have an addiction. It starts mm-hmm. off something kind of smooth. It don't always start off, I just was born into drug alcohol. It's not like that. So people develop things from hurt or whatever, or just kicking it with different type of people, rich people, and before you know it, you're addicted to something.
Mm-hmm.
And so do you stop loving them? No. So that kind of boundary, nah, but how they're in your personal space and what they're affecting is what you have to put your boundaries on, in my mm-hmm. opinion. I had another point. And then you can't help someone who's not ready.
Okay, but that's
I don't
good.
Care. You know, it's easy to point fingers at people, but I've watched people leave this planet Earth too. But like, it wasn't nothing you can do if it's you can offer and guide and all of that. Some people feel like they just don't need no help. So this is my way. I like this. I like to kick it like this.
Right.
So at that point, like it's easy to point fingers, but it's so unfair because you losing a loved one, and
right.
then you have somebody blaming you for something that person chose.
Right.
So that's kind of selfish on people to judge.
Okay.
To me, because if you're not in it, you don't know the story. You don't know what's all going on, because more than likely, everybody in his circle has tried to tell him to slow down. It's, anybody that's loving you, right, have any kind of concerns about you will say something, but you only can go so far. A person got to get tired or say, okay, enough is enough or whatever. And then you can help them after they start their journey. But you can't just say, you shouldn't say, oh, well, it's this person's fault or why they didn't help him. Because mm-hmm. I'm sure plenty of people did. And with a prayer warrior, when he pray behind that, like he know. So he was enjoying whatever he had going on.
Mm.
So, through pain and enjoyment, I'll say it that way.
Okay.
But
fighting two forces.
Right. So
wrestling with two forces. Bentley, I want to go back to you when we had paused with you, when you were saying about the celebrities, the functioning addicts and how they were functioning. And then you got to the part when you said, when they found themselves and you yourself as well, saying, wait a minute, it's starting to be noticed what I'm doing now. Now it's starting to be noticed. I'm doing things a little different now. I'm like you said, being erratic and all of that. Can you go a little bit with that for me?
Yes, and I was gonna, and I'm glad we came back to that because I guess it'll tie into what I was about to say.
Okay.
Just really, truly understand that you have no control. You are literally, you are at the mercy of the drug. When you become a drug addict, you are no longer in control. A lot of times, it's almost as if you don't use the drug, you feel. I can only express for myself that everything in you is shut down.
Mm.
It's your body no longer functions. Your hands don't want to move. You can't communicate with people. You can't step outside.
So do you find yourself getting cleaned up, a relapse, getting back up again? Do you go through those cycles?
I was going to say there's a time when you get to, it's what they call rock bottom. That's when you know.
I've heard that term. What about you, Barb? When you don't hit rock bottom, there's just no more where it does to go.
But if you don't hit that rock bottom, a lot of times you think that you are in control and that you I can quit anytime. I can stop. I can. You can say that a million and one times, but doesn't necessarily make it true. But that's when most people that hit rock bottom are able to say, okay, now I realize there's no further. I can't go anywhere but up from here.
Okay. Yeah?
When you get to that place, then you realize you're crying out and you're reaching out. And there's something inside of you that says, okay, you still have a little strength, and that strength enables you to get up and begin to walk again. But celebrities, a lot of the greats,
Did y'all hear about Black Rob passed away last night?
I didn't even hear that.
Black Rob passed away.
A lot of the greats use drugs, you know, a lot of things to keep them going, basically to tap into a place that they wouldn't be able to tap into had they not indulged in whatever it is, popping pills, shooting tune, whatever it is that they do, right? And it's almost like, I mean, I can just tell you, it's like you're in a different dimension, but you're right here amongst the other people, but they don't, you are in a whole different dimension in the world. You're here, and as soon as you engage, indulge in the drug, you enter into a completely different dimension, and some people thrive there.
Had you ever had to cut somebody off, you know, the other part, I guess to go with the boundary, had you ever had to cut somebody off that loved so much, whether it was alcohol, whatever, you know, that it was going too far to where I got to cut you off? And if so, how did it make you feel? I guess I want to put myself out there on the forefront with that one, because it happened to me so many times. I won't, because for the sake of, you know, her identity, I won't release her name, but a real good friend of mine, I had probably two good friends I've had in my time that I really would like I could call my best friends, that I met these women, good, you know, decent women, there's some decent lives. Like you said, for one, functioning to where, you know, okay, she got it, she good, right? Then all of a sudden it's like, wait a minute, you going too far. And then the moment, you know, I'm starting to say what you're doing, now I'm becoming to be I wouldn't say a threat, but now I'm bothering you now. Or now you think you're better than me. Y'all been there before. You think you're better than me. No, I care, but I'm seeing you really stumbling to where it done got so bad now in their health right now. And everything just done went, like, for honestly, to this day, yes, their body have deteriorated. They done had strokes and all types of things, you know. And then also, going back with that, I have people saying, well, if she's around them, she must be doing it with them.
Uh-huh.
Have y'all, have either one of you all ever experienced that before at all? With, you know, with a coping with a loved one?
Oh my God.
Well, I have had to cut people off. You don't stop loving a person, but you have to put yourself in a safe place as well, because, you know, you try not to kick people when they down. And, so, you know, my mouth, I can say some stuff, not in my heart is not, I'm not trying to be kicking people, but, you know, sometimes for some reason, people like to hear a lie, and I can be truthful with you, but I also try to encourage people. Okay. You know, the people that's been around, but you know, you only can do that so much, and sometimes it caused so much pain in the heart to watch it and to be around it and you know, they know better, but you know, by me not really having an addiction, I don't understand the dependency that Bentley was talking about.
Exactly. Bentley, thank you for that information. Right.
So that was like some huge information.
It
like,
was, you know.
I don't realize that they really depend, you know, it becomes a dependency in order to function. Feel like you're doing what you want to do, or however you're trying to get there.
Right.
So, but you know, I have had to cut people off, people that I love dearly.
Right.
And, you know, but it's just like with anything else, I've cut people off for different reasons, not just drug and alcohol. So it kind of, it's got, you know, it's just boundaries for everything.
I can love you from afar. You know, I'm here for you, but I just can't I just can't ride this ride with you right now. But I'm here for you though. I got you, right? I just can't ride this ride. Bentley, what you want to put in? I know we got a few minutes to go on here. What you want to add to what Barb just said?
Were you finished, Barb?
Yes.
You okay?
I was going to say, you know, that's interesting that you just said where I was going to go with that. The Bible talks about guarding your heart, you know, because it is the wellsprings of life, or the issues of life flow from that. And so, you know, when you love somebody, you see in a person that, you know, they're killing themselves. It, because of the love that you have for them, the more up close and personal you are with them, it does affect you. So in order for you to not allow it to affect you up close and personal, you have to put that space between you to guard that. Because that, like you said, it'll cause you to act out, say something that can cause an offense, you know, all kind of different things. And that was never your goal. Your intent is to try to get them to think, but they can't hear you, you know. Right. Try to get them to respond to what you're saying, but they can't hear you. You know, even if they're looking right at you and they're repeating every word, they can't hear you.
Right.
And so the best bet is to just step back and say, okay, I'm gonna let you, you know, you do this thing. And while I'm over here, I'll pray for you, keep you, if you're praying, if you're a prayer, if you're not, you know, whatever it is, you just gotta keep your distance from it so that it doesn't affect you in that way, because it has the ability to just, you know, destroy a household, a family.
Right, right.
Community, you know, we grew up in communities where all the people, we lived in strong Black communities where everybody worked at AOC.
Right, right.
And then 5 years later, there wasn't a tree in sight, and everybody that we knew that had those jobs was locked in the basement somewhere getting high. Marriages were destroyed. Kids were locked up. Kids were selling parents drugs.
Right.
We watched it, you know, unfold into full fruition. And so at a time when I was selling this stuff, right, call myself out to get rich off of it, and I turn around and I'm using the same
okay
thing. And now I'm so far away from it, and I thank God for it, but I watched my mom die. I watched her, and I remember she said, how did you, how, Trees,
I remember you always shared this, she asked you.
And I said, I just believe that God was going to deliver me.
I was going to ask you that. Out, how did you recover?
Open, my mind was still open and my heart was still open, and I was crying out to God. So, you know, don't discount a person, but keep your distance and watch from afar.
Okay.
And when you see a little bit, you know, don't, you know, people love to say, I don't use drugs no more. They'll be the main ones that still use it. But
okay,
you can go to a person and say, you clean, aren't you? Then you know there's a difference, right? So
Are there any other addiction that people may be struggling with other than drug and alcohol that you all may, you know, you'd be like, wow, really? You know,
sex. Sex.
Okay.
Sex.
Okay. It's real talk. It is.
Right now, I mean, and I'll be honest, and I was just saying to my girlfriend, like, wow, I can't believe I'm literally practicing abstinence, but I had to get to a point where, like, something had to happen for me to really understand what God was calling me to. And I was like, well, this day and age, I just can't trust it anymore. I just can't. But I enjoyed it so that I was willing to say, Lord, that day gonna come and I'm gonna stand before you and be like, I know what you told me, but I just couldn't turn it off.
See, that's what Barb was saying about DMX. She said he could pray, but he was still indulging. So like you just said to yourself, it's wrestling. Sometimes we with the flesh, don't we? We wrestle. Well, mine is Pepsi, y'all. Is that a bad?
Mine is Pepsi because Pepsi is loaded with sugars. Not only that, if you don't drink them, your head
will be hurting.
Yeah.
Well, I ain't gonna say pray for me right now.
I think
until I have to let it go myself. I'm gonna hit right by it with my Pepsi can.
What's yours, Bart?
I think my hardest thing was trying to start saying no to negative talk. Oh. Like, you know how people you don't enter a conversation with negative thoughts and bashing people, but sometimes, like, I will find myself just gone. Like, I'd be like, dang, how did I get this far out on this limb about something that I didn't come here for? I had to really bag myself up a lot just so, because it ain't my problem. And I had to realize that. And I don't want to speak on it because, like I said, trying to come from a place where you not judging people.
Yeah. Okay.
That's a lot of work because I was raised in it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, okay.
It wasn't like it was just all positive, growing up. So trying to get away from it or trying to redirect conversations, or sometimes I have to say, I don't want to talk about them.
Okay.
Like, because most of the time it's the same old thing over and over again. But why do we like to hear it? Like, it's an addiction to what it is. I don't know. I don't even know what I be getting out of it. I mean, you know what I'm saying? I don't know what I was getting out of it. But all I know, I just kind of got tired of it. Like, I got so many things I need to work on myself that I don't want to talk about them. Let's have some money conversations. Let's have some
spiritual
anything than something that's going to put you in a bad space in your mind.
Okay.
So I guess that's mine.
I guess before we close out, what would we like to, share with the viewers, on, dealing with this area, with this coping, with this, this alcohol, drug, and different types of, addictions. As we know, this pandemic bring out the best and the worst with some people, honestly, people was trying to cope, not knowing, began to have anxiety, all type of things going on and really nobody to really go to. And so what would we share with some viewers and people that are watching this, that's going to see this pretty soon, how can we encourage them, where to go and seek and who to, reach out to in case, they, feel alone, I'm by myself. It's what I've been doing.
Well, I will simply
I'm sorry, Bentley. I think it was Black Rob. He became homeless. This is real in closing. Like you said, all this royalty, all this fame, the drug and alcohol, and all of a sudden you're sick, the addiction, and now I'm homeless, no car, no money, no nothing. This is what we've been facing. So what do we, share, in closing with this?
Well, I would say, we all have our vices, right? And how we cope, everybody. We all have something. Some of us, cry. Some of us pray. Some of us use. Some of us, steal away and hide out from people.
Real talk.
Whatever it is, if you feel that it's becoming overwhelming, you're overwhelmed by life, where now whatever this vice is, you feel like you're abusing this vice, what works for me may not work for you.
Okay.
Right? But what worked for me was believing that there was a higher power that was able to pull me out of that pit. And that's where I went, and that's who I sought, and that's who came for me.
All right.
So I also like to say that I love DMX. I don't even know if it was because of how he prayed, but it was he was so real. It was just, it was, you listen to him, you watch him, he was excellent in everything he did.
Yeah.
He was excellent.
Yeah.
I just could not spotlight if I had anything to say about it would not be his drug use.
He was
an amazing actor, a lyricist, rapper, prayer, father, friend, community minister. He did so much for the children, so much for the church, so much for, so I would say that when we look at people, why don't we start spotlighting their good and over their bad? And that's where I'm at with it. That's what I would say, because I love them. And I know many of them, but everybody seems to be veering in on that negative aspect. And it's like, really?
Yeah, we want to look right. I mean, we know that was, like you said, was his past, was what he struggled with, but we want to, like you said, we want to push past forward that now. I believe, we can agree that he accepted Christ. So we're going to allow Bob the Boss to close out, with what you would encourage the viewers, as to what Bentley just, spoke on, if you can, for us.
Okay, so I surely got, disconnected or whatever, but
sorry about that.
To say, encourage yourself, find out who you are, because and find happiness. Try to find happiness somewhere. I mean, I know everybody struggle with all kinds of hurt and pain and suffering and struggling, but you don't need anything to be happy. So I guess my thing is just, you know, with everything slowing down, that just really let us know how much thing, how many things we weren't dealing with.
Yeah.
Because, and so this way we, you can address those things. And if some people get, you know, cause sometimes in the African American families, we're taught not to get help. If you can get some help, sometimes you don't need a counselor, but you need to be able to talk to somebody you love and be honest with yourself. Be open to positivity, not like, and I mean constructive criticism. Somebody you know is not gonna try to really hurt you. They mean well and they got an honest heart. But encourage yourself and figure out who you are. Like getting to know who you are, because if you're not happy with yourself, you're not going to be happy with anything. Yeah. And that's about it.
Wow, that was well said.
What is your closing thoughts, Mocha?
Right here.
Strapped with mad trees and a heart that doesn't bleed. I'm ready for the world, or at least I thought I was.
The writer. Blessed up.
Don't let you pass away and laugh, so I couldn't tell. Loopholes and institutions, prepare myself for jail. They put me in a situation, forcing me to be a man. When I was just learning to stand about a helping hand. Damn, was it my fault or something I did? To make a father leave his first kid at seven.
Doing right
my
there, I thank you, ladies, for chiming in, speaking on this. I know it's going to be helpful to some people that's going to watch this. Thank you, Bentley, for being open, authentic, you know, with what you struggle with. Thank you for, you know, because you put yourself out there. Bob DeBoss, you always come with this Oprah aura, this Ayala. Thank you. You do. It's just for real. Thank you, you know, both of you, you know, for gracing this panel tonight for us. I appreciate it. In closing, rest in peace to the iconic, legendary DMX, Earl Simmons. Sorry, DMX, sorry. You know I love him. And in closing, I just ask anyone who's struggling with addiction, seek some support. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. Don't be embarrassed, you know. Go to a loved one. Let someone know that you're struggling. You know, it's okay. You know, I get, you know, living life, seeing people go through this, you know, I always try to, you know, remain humble without judgment, you know, without judging somebody, you know, and no, I'm here. No, I have not used. Have I been around it? Yes, I have seen it, you know, but being humble and being compassionate with that person, letting them know I don't judge you. But what can I do to try to help you? You feel me?
Amen. So
amen. I guess that's it.
Well, God bless you so much. Just all that.
Yep. And we are the walks of life. Bye. We'll see y'all next time. Thank y'all.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, Mocha.
See you, Bentley.
All right.